Before we move to the screening of the documentary, I will now give the floor to the last speaker on the panel, which is Felix Gnatt, Vice President of the European Vegetarian Union, and he's an environmental economist. So please, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much for inviting me. I want first to introduce myself and the European Vegetarian Union in a few minutes. Then I want to talk about the number of vegetarians and vegans and people who reduce meat in their consumption already in Europe. Then I want to stretch out as a third point the points of contact to European laws and to the European level. We start with our introduction of our organization. The European Vegetarian Union is an umbrella organization of vegan and vegetarian associations and societies throughout Europe. Its main areas of focus are health, nutrition, consumer protection, sustainability, and environmental issues. The EVU is the voice of the growing number of Europeans choosing plant-based products over animal-based nutrition. The EVU puts vegetarian issues on the European political agenda. It is also in the register for interest representatives, and through the membership in the International Vegetarian Union, the EVU is an active part of a worldwide community. My name is Felix Gnatt, and my background is that I'm an environmental economist and I'm vice president for the European Vegetarian Union. You also might know my colleague Till Strecker. He's policy officer for European affairs and consultant in the German Parliament. Or you might know Jens Karsten, who is an independent legal consultant and lobbyist who also is supporting our work. We as an EVU did several projects. One was funded by the European Union with the Leonardo pot of money. It was in professional education, where in four different countries we achieved that teachers are educated and trained in public schools. And nowadays, they teach vegetarian and vegan cooking to their pupils. Also, we have a trademark which allows us to label products all over Europe and worldwide. As you see, there are big companies who are working together with us. Here in Austria, for example, in the biggest supermarket chain and in the second biggest. So now let's come to the number of vegans and vegetarians in Europe. If you read newspapers or watch television, you will notice that there is a different perception of vegetarian and vegan topics in Europe as it used to be 10 years ago. It's on covers of newspapers, here even on the biggest newspaper of Austria, which has a market share of over 50%. And it's covered in television shows about politics, but also about consumer protection. When I'm talking about vegetarianism, the question is, what is meant by it? Is it meant that people consider themselves as vegetarians if they eat less meat? Or is it a vegetarian, which means no meat and fish, or even vegan? If you look at Google, Google Trend allows us to see what terms people type into the Google search engine, and this is a very good indicator of what people are interested in. We start in 2006 and see that we have about the same number of vegetarian and vegan as search keywords. But in 2010, both terms increase very much. And soon you see that the vegan number of searches is much higher than the vegetarian, which is an indicator that veganism is a very hot topic right now. Here you can see the number of vegan cookbooks published in Germany and Austria in 2010. Here you see that the number is four times high in 2011. 2012, we have 27 of these books. 2013, we have a lot of them, I cannot even count anymore. 2014, even more. 2015 is not over yet, but I can tell you it's already a record. One of them, Vegan for Fit from Attila Hildmann, was the number one bestseller in Amazon for 8 months. And his fourth cookbook was sold 200,000 copies on the first day. So there is an interest of the public in these topics. Also, we have figures for Austria that about 65% of the women and 38% of the men eat meat only 3 times per week. They call themselves flexitarians or part-time vegetarians. And 80% of all the people who buy vegetarian products in the supermarket eat meat normally. That means the categories are not so strict anymore than they used to be. In Austria alone, with a population of almost 8 million, we have 4.2 million part-time vegetarians. This is a very big group of people, and I think it's important to address what they are interested in and what they care about. Here is a statistic which is representative for Austria. You see on the right side the green bar. 9% of the people in Austria are vegetarian in 2013. Nowadays it's even 10%. And 1% of the Austrian population, which is 80,000 people, lives a vegan lifestyle, which is 100% plant-based. In the age group to 29, it's 16% vegetarians. And in the age group from 30 to 39, it's 17%. If we look at other indicators, like market share of meat alternatives, here you have figures from Germany. 2008, it starts with 22 million of euros of turnover all meat alternatives together in the supermarkets have. If we look what the growth and increase rates are, we are very impressed, because every year you have an increase of about between 20 and 30%. In times of record unemployment, it's very impressive to see that there are sectors and branches who develop that good like this. In 2013, we almost had 75 million euros of turnover in Germany alone. Let's see the figures on a European level. In Austria, we have 700,000 vegetarians and 80,000 vegans. In Germany, there are 7.8 million vegetarians and 900,000 vegans. But the problem is that in a lot of other countries, we have no accurate data. This is something I will refer to later on. Some other figures, plus 51% of alternatives to dairy in the UK, plus 43% in 2014 of soy yogurt in Germany, plus 36% of vegetarian semi-ready meals in Germany, plus 20% in 2014 Alpro, European-wide, etc., etc. You see, there is much going on in the economy as well. Now let's come to the European level of policy and of politics. In Austria, there was a study carried out by the University of Economics and Business Administration, which looked at the agricultural subsidies. Included in these subsidies was per year 1.2 billion euros from the common agricultural policy from the European Union. And it showed that 64% of the money goes into the livestock sector, especially to beef and dairy, and only 11% is for plant food for human consumption. When we hear how bad livestock is for environment, and on the other side, how heavily the European Union is subsidizing it, it's a very big contradiction. For me, it's a question mark. Why is that like this? For other European countries, we need specific data, but so far there are no categories like this on a European level. Then another important issue is the definition of the terms vegetarian and vegan in the law. Right now, every company can label products as vegetarian or vegan because there are no legally binding definitions for that terms. That means uncertainty for the consumers. We have a trademark which companies can apply for, but it's also not connected with the law. It's just the European Vegetarian Union's definition. Therefore, on a European level, there should be a definition for these terms. And so far, the European Union Food Information Regulation stipulated the European Commission to issue an act defining requirements for information related to suitability of a food for vegetarians and vegans. But there is no progress made. So perhaps in the future this topic will be on the agenda again, but it's in progress. Another topic is calcium enrichment in milk alternatives. There is an algae which is called Lysosemne, which is especially calcium rich. And now it should perhaps not be excluded from organic labeling, which is a problem because calcium enriched organic milk alternatives should be available. Therefore, we suggest that in the paper it should be written algae including seaweed should be replaced with the text algae including seaweed and Lysosemia. In Annex 2, Part 4, number 2, 2, 4, etc., as you can see on my slide, in the paper on the proposal of the Commission. Another point would be connection to the European level school milk program. The European School Milk Scheme is basically a good idea because it should promote healthy food, but in our opinion, plant-based milk should be included as well, and there should be an implementation of suitable education programs. There is another topic, the regulation of novel foods, where we think that there should be a fast-track admission for traditional plant-based foods from a third country with a history of safe use. And one of the most important things, there should be statistics made on a European level. The European Commission should carry out surveys via Eurostat or other authorities, and they should find out the number of vegetarians, the number of vegans, and the number of meat reducers. Research how subsidies are spent should be made as well, and therefore we need new categories. There is also the idea that there should be specific calls for subsidies for innovative products in the plant-based food sector. And I want to close with a quote from Albert Einstein, like Edmund Haverbeck, but it's a different quote. We cannot solve our problems with the same level of thinking that created them. And we heard that a lot of problems are related with animal products, and therefore there should be another solution. Before I close, I want to invite you, everyone who is interested in the topics, especially the legal topics, should contact me afterwards. Thank you very much for listening.
Thank you so much for all the speakers, and I think we can directly go to the screening of the documentary, and we will have at the end, of course, a debate. It's going to be only in English, as we won't have the interpreters at the end of the movie. So enjoy the movie.